You can turn in your Bibles to 2 Chronicles, if you can find it. It's in the Old Testament. 2 Chronicles 20, and we are going to read there in just a moment. How many of you know God is so good? I just love the goodness of God. I love the goodness of God. I declare over you tonight that you are going to be so encouraged when you leave this place, that the power of God is going to touch you, that those of you that feel stuck, that you are going to feel freedom in the name of Jesus. I declare that any depression and discouragement that you may have is lifting off of you right now in Jesus' name. As we hear the word of God, things are going to happen in you. Chains are going to break. Wrong thinking is going to be revealed to you so that you can think like God thinks. Amen. 2 Chronicles, I want to talk to you on this subject, when you don't know what to do. Have you ever been in that place? Have you ever prayed and prayed and nothing happened? You resisted and you resisted and you rebuked until your rebuker wore out. See, Jehoshaphat, I've been there, and Jehoshaphat was there too, and I want us to look at his story tonight. I love the Old Testament stories because the Bible tells us that they are there to encourage us. If you look at this scripture on the monitor, Romans 15:4, look what it says. These things were written in the scriptures long ago to teach us, say teach us, to give us hope, hope, to encourage us, as we what? Wait patiently for God's promises. How many of you are in the waiting stage right now? I'm waiting on some things. You need the wisdom of God. You need the supernatural power of God to move on your behalf. And I think about that scripture in Galatians 6:9 that says, don't get discouraged and give up, because you will reap a harvest. You are going to reap a harvest. Amen. And you will reap it at the appropriate time. It's not always on our time, but God has a perfect timing for you. Amen. And so I believe this story of Jehoshaphat is going to teach you how to walk in faith. It's going to encourage you and give you hope. And I want to do a little something different tonight. As I read the story, I want to teach you from it. I'm not going to read it all up front. I just want to read it, and I want to teach you as the Holy Spirit just illuminates it to me. And so if you want to, you can look on the monitors, because I do have certain words in all caps highlighted, because I'm going to zero in on those words, and you might want to mark them in your Bible, or you might want to write them down, or you can always download my outline after the service, because I have all the points and scriptures on that. At the time of this story, Jehoshaphat was the king of Judah, and the Bible says that he was devoted to the ways of the Lord. It's a miraculous story, so let's get into it. Are you ready? Verse 2. Some people came and told Jehoshaphat, a vast army is coming against you from Edom, from the other side of the Dead Sea. He is already in Hazazon Tamar, which is the En-Gedi. And alarmed, Jehoshaphat resolved in his heart to inquire of the Lord. And he proclaimed a fast for all of Judah. And the people of Judah came together to seek help from the Lord. Indeed, they came from every town in Judah to seek him. Now, I'll stop there. As I studied this story, I could just see faith in action. And I could see that Jehoshaphat was a man of faith, and he shows us how to walk out our faith in a very practical way. And the first thing that I love that the Bible says about Jehoshaphat was that he was afraid. The Bible says when he heard the bad news, he was alarmed, and he was no doubt ready to panic. And why shouldn't he? Because he was outnumbered. The army surrounded him, and he was alarmed. He was afraid, because he's just human like all of us. But what I like, and that's the way we feel sometimes, isn't it? We feel outnumbered. We feel overwhelmed. But this is what I see about this man of faith, that when fear came, he chose instead to respond in faith. And so my first point is this: when fear hits you, choose faith over fear. See, we're all human. We're going to have fear. We're going to have all these emotions that we feel when bad things happen to us. We want to cry. We get worried. We doubt. And we are alarmed like Jehoshaphat. That's totally normal. But in the midst of the fear, we must make a decision that we are not going to live in fear. We are not going to allow fear to overwhelm us. But we are going to stand up and have faith over what we feel. Amen. Faith over our feelings. One of my assignments tonight, I felt so clear from the Lord, is this: to help you grow in your faith. You see, God wants you to develop an unshakable confidence in Him. The Bible says in Hebrews 11:6 that without faith it is impossible to please God, because anyone who comes to him must believe that he exists, and listen to this, and that he is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. God works by faith, and he rewards your faith. He's moved by your circumstances. He's moved by your tears. But let me tell you something, he responds to your faith. Faith, without faith, it is impossible to please God. What is faith? Faith is believing God will do what he said he would do. Faith is trusting God when you don't understand him. Faith is having an unshakable confidence in your heavenly Father. I heard this story years ago. There was a man who was famous for walking tight ropes. And years ago, he would walk across the Grand Canyon and different canyons and high places. And, you know, people would come out, crowds would come out, and they were just so mesmerized by what he did and amazed by him. And one time when he got finished pushing a wheelbarrow across this tight rope, he noticed that this man was just in awe of what he did. And so this man looked at him and said, "You think I can do that again?" And he said, "Oh, I believe you can." He said, "I don't think you really believe I can do that." He said, "Oh, no, you made a believer out of me. I've seen it. You can do that again." And he says, "Okay, jump in." Oh, I have to jump in? You see, that's a different story. Faith is getting in God's wheelbarrow. Faith is jumping in and saying, "God, I trust you. Amen." You see, you take yourself out of your own care and you put yourself in the care of your heavenly Father. Amen. Faith is getting in the wheelbarrow. You just don't believe in your head. You believe in your heart. God wants you to believe in your heart. The challenges of life, they stretch us, don't they? They're hard sometimes. It doesn't always feel good, but it's good for you. It's good for your faith, because the more we use our faith, the stronger it becomes. So if you're in a challenge right now, just remember your faith is getting stronger. You're learning to depend on him, and you can trust him. You can get in the wheelbarrow, amen. So when fear comes, that's when you must choose faith over how you feel. Faith over all those emotions. You know, for 8 years, Kevin and I, you know the story, but we tried to have children, and we did all we could as far as the surgeries, the infertility, and our trust was in God. But I think the hardest time for me was when we went to just have a routine office appointment, and the doctor just sort of blindsided us and said, "You know, Lisa, I don't think we can do anything else for you, and there's a time just to get the H on with your life." And he said, "And here's the name of a psychiatrist, because you might need her." And I, to say the least, I was alarmed. And I was afraid in that moment. All those emotions came. But when we walked out of the office, I looked up at Kevin, and Kevin looked at me, and he declared his faith immediately. He said, "Lisa, our faith never has been in people. Our faith never has been in doctors." He said, "Our faith is in the Lord Jesus Christ." And when he said that, he immediately turned the situation toward God and set an atmosphere for victory in our life. Amen. See, fear will come to all of us. The question is, what are you going to do with it? It's okay to feel fear, but what are you going to do with it? Will you let it control your life, or will you allow the Holy Spirit in you to rise up with a spirit of faith like Jehoshaphat did and like Kevin did? Amen. You see, you have to let your spirit be the dominating and the controlling force in your life. Your spirit is full of the Holy Spirit. You have the power to make a choice. You have the power to choose faith over fear. If your spirit is full of the Word of God, you will be strong to resist that fear and to choose faith over fear. You know, that's why we have to keep our spirit strong, you know. That's why you're here tonight. We've got to read the Word every day. We've got to listen to the teaching of the Word. We've got to be in church so that our spirit is strong. Because how many of you know, if you feed your spirit the bad news and what's on television all the time, your spirit's not going to be strong. You know, that's feeding your flesh and emotions. It just is. I like to do it sometimes. I'm not against TV. I watch TV. I guard what I watch. But what I really work on is I feed my spirit every day and every moment I can, because I want my spirit to be stronger than my emotions. Amen. I want my spirit to be stronger than my feelings. Amen. So that when the devil sends a fiery dart at me, I want to be able to resist it. I want to be able to respond out of my spirit and by the Holy Spirit and get free of that thing. Amen. My point is this, if you find yourself responding out of your emotions all the time, responding out of your feelings, out of fear and worry, then you need to check up on what you're feeding yourself. You see, because Luke 6:45 says, out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. One version says, for the mouth speaks what the heart is full of. What is your heart full of? Kevin spoke to me in faith because he was full of the Word of God. You see, if you get somebody that's filled with the Spirit, full of the Word of God, if you just touch him, the Word comes out. And that's what happened. Of course, you know the rest of the story, God bless us, with three amazing children. But anyway, so for those of you who don't know, our girls are about to be 20 and our son's about to be 17. But in the midst of the fear, Jehoshaphat chose to trust God. And so then he shows us what faith looks like. The second thing he did is this, and this is my second point. Faith always seeks God and inquires of the Lord. Faith seeks God and inquires of the Lord. You know, some people will talk to person after person about their problems before they ever talk to God about it. Okay, I'm guilty of that sometimes. I've done that mainly in the past. I'm training myself to seek God first. To as Joyce Meyer says, don't go to the phone, but go to the throne. You know, it's okay to talk to people, but not if you're leaving God out. Include him, acknowledge him in all you do. You see, we are earthly creatures, but we have to remember that we have heavenly support. Amen. We're not limited to this natural world. And think about this. We have this open invitation from God himself. He said in James 1:5, if any of you lacks wisdom, let him ask. Say ask. Let him ask of God, and who gives generously to all without finding fault, and it will be given to you. Matthew 7:7 says, ask and you will receive. Seek and you will find. Knock and the door will be opened to you. Listen, God will tell you things that you need to know when you seek him with all your heart. You know, a few years ago, I had this pain in my neck right here. I've told this story before, but I had this pain and it got worse and worse and I started being irritable and I realized it's sort of dominating my life and it would go up and it would hit me into my eye right here. And so I went to the doctor and we just couldn't figure it out. We tried different medicines, it didn't work. And so I was at the point where I didn't know what to do. And so I just said, Lord, we don't know. We don't know what it is, but you know what it is. You know what's going on in my body. And I said, God, I just ask you to reveal it to me. I just left it at that. And so when about 2 or 3 days later, I was walking out to get in my car, and all of a sudden the Lord just dropped in my spirit what it was. I went back to the doctor. He said, that's exactly what it is. He put me on the right medication, and God totally healed me of that pain. It was a nerve. It was a nerve because I clenched my teeth at night. Anybody ever do that? But God revealed that to me because I asked him. So many times we forget to ask him, you have not because you ask not. And if you will ask him, God will even expose the plans of the enemy. I think about in 2 Kings tells a story about the king who wanted to attack the nation of Israel. And every time he would make plans to go against Israel, God would speak to the prophet of Elijah, the prophet Elisha, and he would tell him what the king was saying. And so Elisha would go to the king of Israel and say, they're going to do this, and they're going to do this, and they're going to do this. And so their plans would be thwarted. Well, that king of Aram, he got so infuriated because he thought someone was a traitor in his midst. And he said to his men, he said, who is telling our secrets? And one of his officials said, King, there is a prophet in Israel. And he tells the king whatever you say in your bedroom. You see, when you seek God, the Holy Spirit will expose your enemies. Amen. He will tell you things that you need to know. Amen. Amen. Let's look at verse 5. Verse 5 in chapter 20. Then Jehoshaphat stood up in the assembly of Judah and Jerusalem at the temple of the Lord in the front of the new courtyard, and he said, Lord, the God of our ancestors, are you not the God who is in heaven? You rule all over all the kingdoms. Let me say it again. You rule over all the kingdoms of the nation. Power and might are in your hands, and no one can withstand you. Amen. I could just preach on that right now. I think I will. Number 3 is faith. Faith puts the emphasis on God and not self. You see, Jehoshaphat was saying, God, you are powerful. You rule over all the nations. You rule over these armies that are attacking us. And you know what? All power, all authority is in your hands, and no one can withstand you. God, I'm on your side, is what he's saying. I'm on your side. Listen, we're on God's side. And no one can withstand him. See, we have to take the emphasis off of me. Where so many times it's all about me, me, me. Well, I just can't make it. I don't know if I'm going to make it. I don't know if I can do this. It's so hard. I'm just so overwhelmed. But it's not about what you can or can't do. It's about what God can do. Amen? And so we have to take the emphasis off of us and put it on our almighty, miracle-working, delivering God. Amen? Amen and amen. The next thing that Jehoshaphat shows us is that, number four, faith prays bold prayers. Faith prays with boldness and authority. Jehoshaphat begins to pray this bold prayer and to remind God of the promises he gave to the nation of Israel. I'm going to read it to you in the next verses there. I think it's in 7. God, you gave this land to Abraham, your friend. He's name dropping a little bit, wasn't he? You gave this land to Abraham, your friend, and to all his descendants. It belongs to us. And he said, God, you said, if we are faced with calamity or war or famine or plagues, that we can cry out to you and you will help us and you will rescue us. You've got to remind God of what he says in his word. Bring it to him. Bring it to him. You may be in a financial famine right now. You may be facing a spiritual attack. Maybe calamity has come into your house. But let me tell you something. You got a promise from God. Amen. We've been grafted into the nation of Israel. And we have a promise of God. If we will call upon him, he will rescue us. Remind God of his promises. God said, call upon me and I will answer you. I will show you great and mighty things that you do not know. Let me tell you something. Don't pray puny prayers. Amen. Well, God, I hate to bother you, but if you want to help me, God, you know, if you can do anything, oh my goodness, get some backbone. That's just wishbone. Amen. Those are puny prayers. Amen. And yet we don't serve a puny God. See, that's an insult to him. Puny prayers get puny results. You remember the leper that came to Jesus and he said, Jesus, if you can heal me. Jesus said, are you kidding me? He touched him and healed him. I said, I will. That's what Jesus says. You just ask me because I'll say, I will. I will. That's what God is willing to say. I will. I will heal you. I'm so glad my parents didn't pray puny prayers when I was born with a crippling disease. Thank God I wouldn't even be here if they didn't pray a bold prayer that said, Jesus, you're the same yesterday, today, and forever. You can heal our daughter. She's destined to do something for you. And God completely healed me. Amen. Amen. God tells us exactly how to approach him in Hebrews 4:16. He said, let us therefore come boldly, say that word boldly, to the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in the time of need. One version says this, let us then fearlessly and confidently and boldly draw near to the throne of grace. God wants you to be fearless in his presence. He wants you to be confident and bold in his presence. Amen. A fearless confidence to come into his presence and say, God, I need this. God, I got something big, but God, I know you're a big God. Amen. Years ago, my mother was bold enough to pray a big prayer because she desired a swimming pool. You've heard the story. My dad didn't want a swimming pool. He didn't want to spend the money on a swimming pool. But you know what? She decided to talk to God about it instead of my dad. And she kept praying for a swimming pool. When God had a divine connection for her, she met a couple from Louisiana. They had a special needs son. And my mother was so compassionate and reached out to that son, loved them, encouraged them, and checked on them. What she didn't know was that that man was a builder and he built pools. And he was so touched by the fact that my mother reached out to them. He said, hey, I want to come build you a pool free of charge. Amen. Bold prayers get big answers. Jehoshaphat ended that prayer by saying, for we have no power to face this vast army. We have no power in ourselves to face this vast army that is attacking us. We don't know what to do, but our eyes are on you. Now, there's so many lessons in that one verse, but this is one of them. Faith has humility. Faith has humility. Jehoshaphat wasn't afraid, or he wasn't too proud to say, God, I don't know what to do. God, I'm limited in myself. I don't have the answers. Maybe you're thinking my finances are a mess and I don't know what to do. My child is a mess and I don't know what to do. Or maybe this, I'm jacked up myself and I don't know what to do. But let me tell you something, that's okay. Just pray this simple prayer of humility. God, I don't know what to do, but my eyes are on you. That's faith, amen. And it brings us to number six, and that's this. Faith keeps your eyes on Jesus. Keeps your eyes on, fix your gaze upon him. Don't be moved by your own limitations. Jehoshaphat said, God, it's bad, it looks bad, but my eyes are on you. I don't know what to do, God, but my eyes are on you. I pray that prayer all the time. When I find myself in a place I just don't know what to do, I just say, God, I don't know what to do, but my eyes are on you. 2 Corinthians 4:18 says, so we fix our eyes not on what is seen, but on what is unseen, since what is seen is what? Temporary, but what is unseen is eternal. We have to have a temporary mindset when it comes to our challenges. They do have an expiration date, amen? This too shall pass if you will keep your eyes on Jesus. The psalmist knew, emphasized this truth when he said in Psalm 121, I will lift up my eyes to the hills. Where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. Amen. He will not let your foot slip, it says. The Lord will keep you from all harm. He will watch over your life. The Lord will watch over your coming in, and he will watch over your going both now and, listen to this, forevermore. That's permanent right there. Your trials are temporary, but God's presence in your life is permanent forever. You can trust Jesus. After Jehoshaphat prayed, God responded to him. Because you know why? God always hears your prayers. And God always responds to faith. And look in verse 15. We're going to skip around a little bit, but the Spirit of the Lord came upon a man named Jehazel. And in verse 15 it says, Jehazel stood up. And he said, listen, King Jehoshaphat, and all who live in Judah and Jerusalem, this is what the Lord says to you, and this is what God is saying to you. Do not be afraid. Do not be discouraged because of this vast army, for the battle is not yours, but whose? But God's. So the battle is not mine. Say that with me. The battle is not mine. It belongs to God. Amen. Look down at verse 17. God said, you will not have to fight this battle. Take up your position, stand firm, and you will see the deliverance will give you today, Judah and Jerusalem. There it is again. Do not be afraid. Do not be discouraged. Go out to face him tomorrow, and the Lord will be with you. Now look at verse 21. And after consulting the people, Jehoshaphat appointed men to sing to the Lord and to praise him in the splendor of his holiness. And as they went out at the head of the army, they began to say, give thanks to the Lord, for his mercy endures forever. His love endures forever. And as they began to sing and praise, the Lord set ambushes against the men of Ammon and the men of Moab and Mount Seir, who were invading Judah. And they were defeated. And then it goes on to say that they turned on each other and began to kill each other. The enemy didn't even attack Judah, they attacked each other and slaughtered themselves. Amen. Judah didn't even have to fight. God fought the battle, and God is saying to you, don't be afraid or discouraged by the challenge that is in front of you. Like Jehoshaphat told his men, take up your positions. What is your position? It is a posture of praise and worship. Amen. Number seven is this. Faith always worships in the battle. In the middle of the fear, in the middle of the darkness, in the middle of the hurt, faith always worships in the middle of the battle. Fear doesn't wait. Faith doesn't wait to worship God when the victory's won. No. We worship right now. Now faith is. Amen. Faith says, I'm going to worship God because he's worthy of my praise. I'm going to worship God because he's worthy of my worship. I don't worship for what he can do for me. I worship because of who he is. Amen. You see, faith worships God. Sometimes we think we have to sweat it out and we have to work so hard. And what we really just need to do is to position ourselves with praise and worship. Amen. And as you worship and praise, God is fighting for you. He said, you don't have to fight this battle. The battle belongs to God. So as you worship and as you praise, God is fighting for you. He is frustrating the plans of the enemy. He is moving in supernatural ways that you can't even see. You say, God is not working. How do you know? Do you see God? God is a spirit. There is an unseen spirit realm. When Daniel prayed, the Bible says as soon as his prayer was heard that God dispatched the answer. Daniel didn't see the answer at all. In fact, it was 3 weeks later and the answer, the angel Gabriel came to Daniel and said, from the time you set yourself to pray, God dispatched the answer. But listen what he said. In the meantime, for the last 3 weeks, I've been fighting demon powers in the spirit realm. He said, the spirits fought us. I had to bring in the archangel Michael to help, and we fought off the enemy, and I brought you the answer. So how do you know God's not working? God is working. While you are worshiping and while you are praising, God is fighting your battles for you. He's pushing back the darkness. Oh, if I was Deidre, I would sing it. He's pushing back the darkness, lighting up the kingdom. That cannot be shaken. In the name of Jesus, enemies defeated. In the name of Jesus, sickness is defeated. In the name of Jesus, depression is defeated. Because God is fighting for you. Amen. And I will shout it out. I'll shout it out now. Not when I see the victory. I'll shout it out now. We'll shout it out now, God. Woo! We'll shout it out. We'll shout it out. Praise precedes the promise. Woo! Let me tell you something. I'm not going to pray puny prayers, and I'm not going to give my God puny praise. Because listen to what happens when you give him praise. We're into verse 25. So Jehoshaphat and his men went to carry off their plunder. And they found among them a great amount of equipment and clothing and articles of value, more than they could take away. There was so much plunder that it took 3 days to collect it. On the fourth day, they assembled in the Valley of Baraka, where they praised the Lord. And this is why it is called the Valley of Baraka to this day, because it means praise. Then led by Jehoshaphat, all the men of Judah and Jerusalem returned joyfully to Jerusalem, for the Lord had given them cause to rejoice over their enemies. Whew. Verse 28, they entered into Jerusalem and they went to the temple of the Lord with harps and lyres and trumpets. And the fear of God came on all the surrounding kingdoms when they heard how the Lord had fought against the enemies of Israel. And the kingdom of Jehoshaphat was at peace, for his God had given him rest on every side. God is about to give you rest on every side. You say, Lisa, all I have is hurt and fear on every side. No, no, I prophesy to you today, God is about to give you rest on every side, on your north and the south and the east and the west, with your enemies, with your relatives, with whoever is harassing you. God is about to give you rest, amen. And joy is coming into your life. The Bible says he gave Jehoshaphat cause to rejoice. Man, he's bringing you to a place of peace. And this is my last point. But don't go anywhere because we're going to end different tonight. Sometimes when I say that, people get up. The last point is this. 8, faith takes home more than enough. Faith always takes home more than enough. See, God didn't just deliver the Israelites from the enemy. He rewarded their faith greatly. The Israelites gathered up spoils and they took it home with them so much they couldn't contain it. The Bible says more than they could take away. That's the kind of God we serve. I tell you, he's more than enough. He's a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. Oh, he'll reward you with joy. He'll give you more than enough joy, more than enough peace, more than enough blessing, so much you can't even contain it. Because that's the kind of God we are. Listen, the people got new clothes. I like that. They got new clothes. They got equipment and they got things of value. Now listen to this. And Jehoshaphat named the battlefield the Valley of Barakah because it means a valley of praise. Let me tell you something. A valley symbolizes a dark place. But Jehoshaphat turned that dark valley into a valley of praise. And I want to tell you right now, you can make your darkest valley a valley of praise. Amen. You can turn it on the devil. And you can stomp all over him and say, I'm not going to go through this weeping and afraid. I'm going to praise God all the way through the valley. Amen. I'm going to praise him now, whether I see it or not, because I trust God and I know he is well able. You see, God will turn your battlefield into your blessing field. Amen. And that's what he'll do for you. And, you know, you think about it, how Satan wants to destroy you in the valley. But God will cause you to be blessed in the valley. So not only will God deliver you, you'll take home more than you can carry. Say, I'm taking home more. Every time God has ever delivered me out of something, it's like he's given me more joy. And he's restored things I didn't even think about that I lost. And then some, amen? You remember the scripture in Malachi that he'll open the windows of heaven as you give to him, and you won't even have room to contain it? God is a God of more than enough. And if you keep your faith in him, if you jump in the wheelbarrow, I tell you what, you're going to come away with more than you can handle, amen? Amen, amen. We're going to end tonight. And Deidre's going to lead us into that God is fighting for you, because that's been in my spirit. I want you to go out of here with a shout of praise in your heart. Amen. And then I'm going to pray for you. But let's just bow our heads just a moment. Thank you, Father. Thank you for your mighty, mighty word, Father. For the moving of the Holy Spirit. For your people, Father, that are so precious and just hungering and thirsting after you, Father. I thank you that they will not go out of here the same person. They'll go out in power, Father, in peace, in rest, and joyful, Father. I declare over them what you did for Jehoshaphat, Father, that they'll have more than they can even contain, more than they can even take home, Father. I thank you, Lord Jesus, for it. If you're here tonight and you say, Lisa, I've never really jumped in the wheelbarrow when it comes to giving my heart to the Lord. I've never prayed the salvation prayer. If I died tonight, I don't know where I'd spend eternity. I want to get in on the salvation prayer. I want you to pray for me. I want peace with God. If that's you, I want you to raise your hand all over this building right now. Amen. I see those hands. Amen. Amen. Thank you so much. You can put them down. If you're here tonight and you'd say, Lisa, I have known the Lord. I've been away from him. I've been in sin. I'm not going to ask you what you're doing. I'm just going to pray for you. And you say, I want to get in on that prayer because I want to rededicate my life to the Lord. I want you to raise your hand right now. Amen. Thank you. Thank you for your honesty. Congregation, let's pray this prayer with him so it'll encourage him. Actually, I'm going to ask you to stand up. If you raised your hand, stand up. Let's just make a declaration of faith right now. Be bold. Amen. Thank you. Thank you. The Bible does say that if you're ashamed of Jesus, then he'll be ashamed of you. But if you're not ashamed of him, then God will not be ashamed of you on that day. And so it's good to stand up and make that public declaration. And besides, the ushers are going to put a book in your hands by my brother Joel that will help you. But let's pray together, congregation. Say, Dear God, I come to you just as I am. I'm a sinner. I'm in need of a Savior. I ask you to come into my life, Jesus. I repent of all my sins. I ask you to forgive me. Make me clean. Make me new inside. I want to serve you. I thank you, God, that you'd heard my prayer. And you love me. You accept me. You approve of me. And now I am saved. I have eternal life. God, you are my heavenly Father. Jesus, I publicly declare that you are my Lord and Savior. And I say on this May 23rd, I'm going to serve you all the days of my life. Teach me your ways, O God. Now I want you to put your hand on your heart, those of you that are standing, because I know that many times when we come to the Lord, we come with baggage, and we come with hurt, and we come with pain, and we come with addictions. But you know what? I just believe God can just free you up right now. So in the name of Jesus, Father, I take authority over the plans of the enemy of your people. Father, I thank you that they belong to you, and I pray that you would free them of emotional pain. Father, I pray that you'd heal them in their bodies. I pray that you would free them of any addictions. Father, I thank you that they'll just totally lose the hunger and the thirst and the desire for anything that is evil or is not of you in the name of Jesus. Father, I thank you that you'll guide them all the days of their lives. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Give them a good hand clap. Bless you.